Vachagu Yield Scots, the Celtic Podcast. Nulach Chriel. That's Happy Christmas or Merry Christmas. On today's show, in Fekamich Beckin Gaelic, that's Let's Try a Little Gaelic. And Nulach, Christmas. Words about Christmas, that thing. In Celtic history, we're going to talk about kind of a touchy subject, Scottish slaves in America. In everyday Celtic ways, the Manx connection to the HMS Bounty. And we'll hear music from Liam Clancy, Julie Fallis, and Capra Cayley. And as always, it's a wee bit of Irish trivia to test your knowledge to start us off. When and what is Nulach Noáin? All right. Check out the Yield Scot Facebook group where you can be a part of the Celtic culture. Keep an eye out for the Celtic Badass of the Week, Celtic Music Spotlight, learn a Gaelic song videos, and I'm beginning to post new video series for Wednesdays called Dark Celtic History. If you have any stories or tales of dark Celtic history, let me know in the Facebook group. Cairis Maha, let's kick this thing off.
3, 2, 2.
He can bat alioro, alicum nalio, Mahamad Hayoro, alicum nalio, be Mahadinch alioro, alicum nalio, Smatuth Rathan Hayoro, alicum nalio, Mohiladon alioro, alicum nalio, Edrav Brahat Hayoro, alicum nalio, Sievat Misha alioro, alicum nalio, Edma Vaha Hayoro, alicum nalio, Tokiat me alioro, Alicum nalio, et neravan heyoro, alicum nalio, maruskin down alioro, alicum nalio, snavna farake heyoro, alicum nalio, mohulin down alioro, alicum nalio, meskin garakin heyoro, alicum nalio, mavraj erekage alioro, alicum nalio, a mesna gaya heyoro, alicum nalio, habendach tres alioro, alicum nalio, chutkan. Drai mi heyoro, alicum nalio, mian tuliask alioro, alicum nalio, mian barnio heyoro, alicum nalio. Sadi ele alioro, alicum nalio, come a fashion heyoro, alicum nalio, fed you blian alioro, alicum nalio, but I got you heyoro, alicum nalio, a fed blian alioro, alicum nalio, now I watch a heyoro, alicum nalio, got me e alioro, alicum nalio, as a hula heyoro, alicum nalio, yeri anoch alioro, Alicum nalio, Kiervat heyoro, alicum nalio, Mayer canaia alioro, alicum nalio, Aksukin sal heyoro, alicum nalio, Oma volok alioro, alicum nalio, Ekbeniati heyoro, alicum nalio, Skaki misha alioro, alicum nalio, Sensiet vati heyoro, alicum nalio, Sikam bata alioro, alicum nalio, Maham. Mado heyoro, alicum nalio, Sievat misha alioro, alicum nalio, Etma vaha heyoro, alicum nalio, heyoro, alicum nalio.
All right, that was Hickambata by Julie Fallis from her From Me album. And now it's time for Fekamich Beckin Gaelic. Let's try a little Gaelic. Now, I'm not an authority on the Gaelic language, I just love learning it, and I struggle like most. I want to help. What I teach comes right from well-respected Gaelic teachers, so I hope you find it interesting, informative, and fun. I always display what I'm talking about on the screen, and today we're going to be talking about An Nulach, Christmas. And we're going to go through a few words that have to do with Christmas. So, the first, of course, is An Nulach, Christmas. Then, Happy Christmas. Now, there's a few versions of this, but the one that's generally used is Nulach Chriel. Okay? Then you got Ias Christa. Then you got Filmican Nulach. Lavreican Nulach. We got Cruve Nulach. Kersh Nulach or Kerstin Nulach. Santa Claus was Bodach na Nulach. Then you got Pleasant. For presents, stocking, for stocking, or stockinen for stockings. Then you have Louis Nolik for carol, Christmas carols. Kerk Herlikuk for turkey. Party for party. And Fieg Lach Lenok for reindeer. All right. If you're looking for more stuff like this, check out the website at the bottom, www.gaelicforparents.com. It's a great site, great resource for Gaelic information. All right. Hope you enjoyed. Feckemich back in Gaelic. That was The Tree by Capra Cayley on their album Beautiful Wasteland. Now today in Celtic history, we're going to talk about a touchy subject. It's all about Scottish slavery in America. Now Scots, they have this deep-seated hatred for English. Not all of them, but I still do a lot of them. And they may not, and they have right to be, but they may not be vocal about it as much these days. But if you study the Scots history with the English, then you have more than enough examples as to why. And this is just one of many. Now, as many as 500 Scottish POWs captured at the battles of Worcester or Dunbar were shipped to New England in the 1650s as slaves to work in iron mills, sawmills, and farms. But they were just the beginning. I know 500 doesn't sound like much, but remember, the population of the American colonies in 1650 was only 50,368 people. The first settlement in Jamestown was really only about 41 years old. The Great Migration of Puritans had ended, and the colonists badly needed workers. Across the sea, Oliver Cromwell's new government had the costly and vexing task of managing thousands of Scottish POWs. The best solution presented for the Scottish POW problem was to deport them as slaves to New England. Now, Virginia and Barbados as well, but now, some of the Scottish POWs sent to New England were sold as a group to work in the Saugus ironworks of the sawmills and of Berwick, Maine. Others went to York as servants, and still others were sold individually. Now, the Puritan minister, John Cotton, defended the practice when he wrote, "The Scots who God delivered into our hands at Dunbar and were of sundry were sent hither. We have been desirous as we could to make their yoke easy, such as were sick of scurvy and other diseases, have not wanted the physic and surgery. They have not been sold for slaves to perpetual servitude, but for 6, 7, or 8 years, as we do what they call indentured servants." Now, by the way, this is where that term indentured servants comes from. As one historian noted dryly, though, Cotton's sanctions deadened the New England's conscience, and the records of the time showed that his 6, 7, or 8 years was more like a death sentence, given the grueling, hard, long work that the Scottish slaves were forced to endure. Now, Cromwell, he executed King Charles I in January of 1649. And the Scottish people had sided with Cromwell, but they turned on Cromwell and declared Charles's son king. In the summer of 1650, Cromwell and his forces then invaded Scotland. The Scottish Parliament, in response, conscripted thousands of young Scottish men between the ages of 19 and 25, though some were as young as 12. They clashed at the short but brutal Battle of Dunbar, and within an hour, 12,000 Parliamentarians, battle-hardened, experienced soldiers defeated 11,000 Scots, who were mostly farmers and tradesmen, killing as many as 2,000, while losing only 20 men. Cromwell's army released thousands of sick and wounded Scots, but then marched the remaining Scottish POWs like cattle to Durham, 100 miles away. Now many perished of hunger or disease on the forced march. Though a few did escape, most were just simply executed. Now, in Durham, the English imprisoned the Scottish POWs in the castle and cathedral. About 1,600 of them died of dysentery, disease, or starvation due to the horrific conditions there. The English had them buried in mass graves, which the English denied until a recent discovery of the mass graves. Now, 2 months after the battle, 150 Scottish POWs were boarded on the ship Unity and sailed to London. Then to Charleston, Massachusetts. The shipmaster, Augustine Walker, paid £5 for each man and then sold them for £20 to £30. Technically, they signed contracts agreeing to the indentured servitude, but in reality, most spoke only Gaelic and were illiterate. So, about 50 of them went to the Saugus Ironworks, the first successful ironworks in the colonies. Now, it produced much-needed iron bars for tools, building materials, and cooking implements, but the Scottish POWs worked 16-hour days, 7 days a week, at hard, dangerous labor on very little sustenance. They worked as woodcutters to supply the wood to make charcoal, or as forge hands, blacksmiths, miners, and farmhands. Another 25 Scottish POWs were taken to the Nowichawanik River, now the Salmon Falls River in Berwick, Maine. They went with an Englishman named Richard Leader, who got hold of an abandoned mill. Leader put the Scottish laborers to work sawing Maine white pine trees, which he sold. They were needed very badly for the British Navy. Valentine Hill also bought some of the Scottish POWs from the Battle of Dunbar and worked them as in his sawmills at Durham Falls and the Lamprey River in New Hampshire. Exactly 1 year after the Battle of Dunbar, Cromwell's much larger force defeated 16,000 mostly Scottish army at Worcester, England. It was the last battle of the English Civil War. 3,000 men died in battle, and 10,000 were taken prisoner. According to tradition, the English lined up the Scottish POWs in order to shoot every 10th man. A Highlander named Mickham McIntyre saw his number would soon be up, and he broke rank and ran for his life. A horseman chased him down and wounded him, but spared his life. The English then drove the Scottish POWs like cattle, without rest or food, into England, into London. Now, a witness described them, the Scottish POWs, as all of them were stripped, many of them cut, some with stockings or shoes, and scarce so much left upon them as to cover their nakedness. They ate peas and handfuls of straws in their hands, which they had pulled upon the fields as they passed. In London, the English confined them outdoors in artillery fields. Again, many died of disease, starvation, exposure, while the government debated what to do with them. About 275 Scottish POWs were sent to Boston about the John and Sarah, which is a ship, where Thomas Kemble, a Charleston merchant, took them on consignment. Now, Kemble found a ready market among planters and mill owners for the human cargo. As the news spread about the first shipment of Scottish POWs, so when the second shipment arrived, Kemble easily sold the Scottish POWs in many of the Massachusetts towns. Kemble sold others in New Hampshire and Durham, too, where he partnered with Valentine Hill. So many ended up in York, Maine, that for years, and the town had the nickname of Scotland. Daniel Black, who came over on the John and Sarah, probably got sold to the son of Reverend Zechariah Sims, one of the Charleston's most prominent citizens. In 1654, Black assaulted and beat up his master, and a court sent him to prison in 1654. Black apparently left prison, married, and had children. And New York Governor Frank S. Black traced his ancestry to the Scottish POW. The Scottish POWs were all still of marriageable age when they got freed from their bondage, those that survived, of course, and many did marry. Some married the Irish housemaids, who were also brought over here to the colonies as slaves. Few ever returned home to Scotland. Most Scottish slaves died during their servitude, whether it be the mines, logging, or any other number of dangerous jobs given to them here in America. They were considered the really lucky ones because their suffering had ended. Only a small percentage of Scots prior to 1700 ended up marrying the boss's daughter or received land grants. Most who survived their time of servitude were scorned by everyone, viewed as the same or less than blacks or Indians. Now, these Scots would parse out a meager existence for years to come, or take any chance at a better life. Scots fought in every war that came along, and many went off into the unknown lands of America as trappers, hunters, and explorers. They survived, and when the next wave of Scots came to American shores, they had a little bit of a better welcome because of the hard work and the respect that those that had come before them had built. See, the Scottish POWs that came over here and managed to survive their servitude, which was few, went on to do great things and become great people, and therefore built that respect so that the later waves of Scottish immigrants and Irish immigrants who came over here had it better. All right, that's it for Celtic History Break.
come all you young rebels, and list while I sing. For the love of one's country is a terrible thing. It banishes fear with the speed of a flame, and it makes us all a part of the patriot game. My name is O'Hanlon, and I'm just gone 16. My home is in Monaghan, where I was weaned. I've learned all my life cruel England to blame, and so I'm a part of the patriot game. It's barely 2 years since I wandered away with the local battalion of the bold IRA. I'd read of our heroes, and I wanted the same, to play up my part in the patriot game. They told me how Connolly was shot in a chair, his wounds from the battle all bleeding and bare, his fine body twisted, all battered and lame. They soon made him part of the patriot game. This island of ours has for long been half free. 6 counties are under John Bull's tyranny. So I gave up my boyhood to drill and to train, to play my own part in patriot game. And now as I lie here, my body all holds, I think of those traitors who bargained and sold. I wish that my rifle had given the same to those quislings who sold out the patriot game.
All right, that was The Patriot Game by Liam Clancy. Now it's time for Everyday Celtic Ways. Today we're going to be talking about the mutiny on the Bounty and its connection to the Isle of Man. The British Navy has a long and storied history, but the credit for its dominance has largely been hidden. While it is strictly British in every way, the majority of the crews on board British ships during the time of the HMS Bounty were made up of men from places like Scotland, Ireland, Wales, Cornwall, and Isle of Man. Britishness wasn't a prerequisite for acceptance. Many of the captains and under-officers had to be versed in many of the Celtic languages in order to even sail their ships with complete control. Now, the Isle of Man in particular has a strong connection with the famous mutiny, which has been the subject of 3 Hollywood films. The mutiny occurred aboard HMS Bounty in 1789 near Tonga. The armed transport vehicle's aim was to acquire breadfruit plants from Tahiti before transporting them to grow in the West Indies. After spending 5 months on the island collecting the plants, the ship set sail. But on the 20th of April, 1789, everything changed. 1,300 miles west of Tahiti, the ship was taken bloodlessly and apparently without struggle from any of the Loyalists except the captain, William Bligh. Now, HMS Pandora was sent out by the Admiralty in November 1790 in pursuit of the Bounty, you know, after it was delayed in coming back, to capture the mutineers and bring them back to England to face a court-martial. Now, she arrived in March of 1791 and captured 14 men within 2 weeks. However, the ship was later wrecked on the Great Barrier Reef with the loss of 35 lives. The Maine's connection, the Isle of Man connection, lies with Lieutenant William Bligh, who was the captain of the Bounty and whom no one could say wasn't as British as they come. He was married to the old parish church of Unchon. His wife, Elizabeth Betham, lived at The Hague, which still stands off Summerhill Road in Unchon. Both his and his wife's graves can still be seen in the Unchon churchyards today. Now, Fletcher Christian was also aboard the boat. He was the guy who played Marlon Brando played, and was from a branch of the famous Christian family of Milltown, Lezaire. Midshipman Peter Haywood was son of the Deemster of Nunnery Estate in Douglas. He was just age 17 when the Bounty sailed, and it was his first voyage. Haywood was sentenced to death, though, not for taking part in the mutiny, but for failing to suppress it. But he was later pardoned and went on to serve with distinction in the Royal Navy for over 27 years. All right, that's kind of a cool connection there. And that's it for Everyday Celtic Ways.
Let's go,
ойет каляхыгы ойнет санывана ойет каляхавы илет санывана ойет каляхыгы ойнет хуны кимдо ове каляхавы илет санывана ойет каляхыгы ойн санывана ойет каляхавы илет санывана ойет каляхыгы ойнет хуны кимдо ове каляхавы илет и хот каляхыгы ойн и хот каляхавы илет и хот каляхыгы ойн санывана ойет каляхавы илет и хот каляхыгы ойн и хот каляхавы илет
That was a Porsche Bail set called Rivenin Riavac by Julie Fallis, and that's on her Gaskol album. Well, that's it for today's show. I hope you liked it. I'm trying to keep it interesting, informative, and fun while showing you the beauty of all things Celtic. Topolava Harrison. Now, before I let you go, the trivia question answer. All right, ladies, you need to listen up. You need to keep this date in mind. Remember this date. January 6th in Ireland is called Little Women's Christmas. Nulaghnawain. Now, this is when the men in your life take over the housework or the work you do for for each day to show their appreciation for all that you do for them. All right. I think this is a good thing for you women to try to get going in your family. All right. Remember to check out my YouTube channel, Yield Scott. It's got Learn a Gaelic Song videos, Celtic Badass of the Week videos, Celtic Music Spotlight, Celtic Podcast, Speaking Our Language, and the new Dark Celtic History videos, and of course, lots more. And my Facebook group, Yield Scott, where you can give me all your insights and inputs on things Celtic. Marcin Leave and Drosda. Bye for now. I'll let you go with a song, though. The Haggis by Kepper Cayley on their Crosswinds album.